to kick off tonight's program, I'm really, really pleased to see so many of you. We dedicate tonight's event to the memory of our beloved friend and colleague, Neely Sharon Adler. Neely's passion and commitment to the community and all things Hebraic continues to serve as a source of inspiration. We thank Moshe for joining us to celebrate her legacy through tonight's program. Of course, our Israeli author's events were Neely's brainchild. I know how much you would have enjoyed not only interacting with our guest, but more importantly, how much you would appreciate so many of you joining us to celebrate Israeli literature with one of the stars of the Israeli literary scene today. So our honored guest this evening is Etgar Keret, whose books are bestsellers in Israel, have been published in over 30 languages. His books include Bus Driver Who Wanted to Be God, Missing Kissinger, and Gaza Blues. His most recent book of stories, Suddenly a Knock on the Door, was published in 2010, was an instant number one bestseller in Israel. His latest book, The Seven Good Years, is a nonfiction account of his personal life and is almost available in English, just not quite. So unfortunately, we don't have copies of that here this evening. His other books will be available for sale and signing in the back after he speaks. He has received the Book Publishers Association Platinum Prize several times, the Chevalier Medallion of France's Order of Arts and Letters. He has been awarded the Prime Minister's Prize and the Ministry of Culture Cinema Prize in Israel. More than 40 short movies have been based on his stories, one of which won the American MTV Prize. As a filmmaker, Keret is the writer of several feature screenplays, including Skin Deep, which won first prize at several international film festivals and was awarded the Israeli Oscar. Wrist Cutters, featuring Tom Waits, was released in 2007. Jellyfish, his first movie as a director, along with his wife Shira Geffen, won the coveted Camarade d'Or Prize for first best feature at the Cannes Film Festival in 2007. The animated feature film 999, based on several of Keret's stories, marries the tradition of Jewish self-flagellating humor with uncanny absurdity, showing miracles coexisting with the mundane, offering a beguiling view of what hope looks like in a hauntingly fragmented world. And sometime, when he finds some time away from all these creative activities, he also teaches at Ben-Gurion University. Please join me in welcoming back to Cleveland, Etgar Keret.
Thank you. Thanks. Okay. Hello. I'm very happy to be here. My first visit here was 5 years ago, and Neely had invited me here. I told her that I speak in many places, but that my talk here was very special, because I always, when you come to speak, you know, you can meet wonderful audiences, but you always feel as a guest. And I said to Neely that with you, I feel at home. I feel like you're some kind of a newly discovered relative, an aunt who takes care of me and who wants me to improve in some things, and you know, and and she had this kind of warmth that won me in a second. And I must say that I came coming here 5 years later. I came here. I am very ill. I have a stomach virus and a fever. And the moment I got here, all the people in this place started taking care of me and bringing me rice and looking for medicine. So I'm glad that this warm spirit that I first met here with Neely is still around, and that I can still feel here at home. the first story I want to read is, it's loosely connected to my father in a very strange way. I want to say that, you know, that many times when people ask me what is my greatest literary influence, I always talk about writers, you know, Kafka, Pashevi Singer, Shalom Aleichem, and other writers. To be honest, I think that the strongest literary influence that I had was the bedtime stories that my parents had told me. My parents are both Holocaust survivors. My father died 3 years ago, and he survived the war hiding in a hole in the ground with his family for 620 days. His sister didn't survive, but him and his parents survived the war. My mother had survived the war. She began it in the Warsaw Ghetto, and she lost both her parents and a brother, and she was the sole survivor of her family. And one of the most pleasant memories that she had from her childhood were the stories that her parents would tell her before she would go to sleep. And because they told her those stories in the ghettos, they had no access to children book. So they had to make up those stories. And she really liked the fact that they were making up stories especially for her. It made her feel very special. And when she had her own family, she wanted to keep this tradition. And that's why both my parents, who were very, very literary, you know, and my mother, both my mother and my father, one of them could read and write in 7 languages and the other in 6 languages. And all our house was full with books, but we hardly had any children books. And even the ones that we had were books that we got as presents and we would read to ourselves. But when the evening came, we always knew that my mother would come and tell us a bedtime story. And every time there would be a new story. For my mother, she of course knew that she could buy a book and read to us, but she wanted us to feel special. And for her, reading a book to us was like ordering pizza instead of making a fresh dinner, you know? So she would tell us those wonderful stories, which she could invent at ease. But there were times where she couldn't tell us stories because she was busy either with work or she didn't feel well or she had other commitments. And then my father had to tell us stories. And my father, who was a very charismatic man and a very good storyteller, couldn't make up stories. He could just tell us things that had really happened. And in a strange way, those stories, which were much rarer, because my mother was always the plan A, you know, were the ones that I kind of yearned more for. There was something that made me love mankind more, you know, when I've listened to them. There was something very Hasidic in them, and not because the people in them were good. Actually, many times they were not. But there was something maybe in the storytelling or in the intention of the storyteller to always to find goodness in them, always to find a way to advocate for their action, always to find a remorse in them for the bad things that they had done. And I really, really loved those stories. And those stories, they had one thing in common. They always took place in a whorehouse, and their protagonists were always prostitutes and drunk people. And as a 5-year-old, I asked my father, "Father, what's a prostitute?" And he said, "Ah, well, a prostitute is somebody whose work is to listen to other people's troubles." And I said to him, "Okay, and what's a drunk person?" And he said, "Well, a drunk person is somebody who has these physical conditions that the more liquid he drinks, the happier he becomes." And it was at the age of 5 that I've decided that when I grow up, I want to become a male drunk prostitute. But as I grew older, I understood that my father was telling me stories that maybe one is not supposed to tell kids. And I think when I was about the age of 10, I confronted him about it. I said to him, "You know, like when I was younger, you would tell me all those stories. Why did you tell me those stories?" And my father, who was a very, very sincere man, he said to me, "I'll be honest with you. Whenever I would lie in bed next to you, my first thought would be, you're a child. Maybe I'll tell you a story from my childhood, from my young years. But I didn't want to tell you the story of how they tortured my sister to death, but she would still not give up my hiding place. Or the story of how when the Russian liberated our place, our muscles were so contracted that we couldn't even move, you know, they had to drag us out of the hole. Or all those horrible things that were a part of my mind. So whenever I would stick at an age, I would say, no, I can't tell that, and I would fast forward and go a little bit further and further. And the thing was that after the war was over, we tried to immigrate to Israel. We were caught by the British and sent to Cyprus. I escaped the camp in Cyprus and joined the Irgun. The Irgun fought the British, and they said to me that if I want to help, being stuck in Europe, that I should help them buy firearms. So very quickly, I found myself in southern Italy buying arms from the mafia. But because I had no money, I would sleep at night in public parks. And after a few days, the mafia people told me, this is a small town and everybody sees that we do business with you and then that you sleep in parks. It's not good for our reputation, you know, that we're dealing with homeless people. And I said to him, listen, all the money for the weapons, it comes from the Irgun. Personally, I don't have any money. I would also rather have a roof over my head. I just can't afford it. And they said, you know what? Our family, we have this old family business. We have a whorehouse. And business are good, but you can always find, you know, an empty bed there, and you can always get some sleep there if you want. And he said, and I went there, and actually this was the first years of my life in which I could tell people freely that I'm a Jew, in which I would meet unkindness, but not in the way that I've met it in the war. And he said, those mafia guys, you know, compared to the Nazis, they were very nice. He said, like, you know, when they kill somebody, I would see them getting drunk and feeling bad, you know. So I thought this is something that it's maybe okay to tell you as a child. And I think that the legacy of those stories still stays with me. So the first story I read is actually the last story in my last stories collection. And since the next book that will only be out in June is nonfiction, then you can see some kind of transformation from nonfiction to fiction. The story itself is fiction, but still I appear in it as a character, so maybe it prepares the next book. What animal are you? The sentences I'm writing now are for the benefit of the German public television viewers. A reporter who came to my home today asked me to write something on the computer because it always makes for great visuals. An author writing. It's a cliché, she realizes that, but clichés are nothing but an unsexy version of the truth. And her role as a reporter is to turn that truth into something sexy, to break the cliché with lighting and unusual angles. And the light in my house falls perfectly without her having to turn on even a single spot. So all that is left is for me to write. At first, I just made believe I was writing, but she said it wouldn't work. People would be able to tell right away that I was just pretending. Write something for real, she demanded, and then, to be sure, a story, not just a bunch of words. Write naturally, the way you always do. I told her it wasn't natural for me to be writing while I was having my picture taken for German public television, but she insisted. So use it, she said. Write a story about just that, about how unnatural it seems, and how the unnaturalness suddenly produces something real, filled with passion, something that permeates you from your brain to your loins, or the other way around. I don't know how it works with you, what part of your body gets the creative juices flowing. Each person is different. She told me how she once interviewed a Belgian author who every time he wrote had an erection. Something about the writing stiffened his organ. That's the expression she used. It was probably a literal translation from German, and it sounded very strange in English. Write, she insisted. Great. I love your terrible posture when you write. The cramped neck. It's just wonderful. Keep writing. Excellent. That's it. Naturally, don't mind me. Forget I'm here. So I go on writing, not minding her, forgetting she's there, and I'm natural. As natural as I can be. I have a score to settle with the viewers of German public television. But this isn't the time to settle it. This is the time to write. To write things that will appeal. Because when you write crap, She's already reminded me it comes out terrible on camera. My son returns from kindergarten. He runs up to me and hugs me. Whenever there's a television crew in the house, he hugs me. When he was younger, the reporters had to ask him to do it, but by now he's a pro. Runs up to me, doesn't look at the camera, gives me a hug and says, "I love you, Daddy." He isn't four yet, but he already understands how things work, this adorable son of mine. My wife isn't as good, the German television reporter says. She doesn't flow, keeps fiddling with her hair, stealing glances at the camera. But that isn't really a problem. You can always edit her out later. That's what's so nice about television. In real life, it isn't like that. In real life, you can't edit her out, undo her. Only God can do that, or a bus if it runs her over, or a terrible disease. Our upstairs neighbor is a widower. An incurable disease took his wife from him. Not cancer, something else. Something that starts in the guts and ends badly. For 6 months, she was shitting blood. At least that's what he told me. 6 months before God Almighty edited her out. Ever since she died, all kinds of women keep visiting our building, wearing high heels and cheap perfume. They arrive at unlikely hours, sometimes as early as noon. He's retired our upstairs neighbors, and his time is his own. And those women, according to my wife at least, they're whores. When she says whores, it comes out natural, like she was saying turnip. But when she's being filmed, it doesn't. Nobody's perfect. My son loves the whores who visit our upstairs neighbor. "What animal are you?" he asks them when he bumps into them on the stairs. "Today I'm a mouse, a quick and slippery mouse." And they get it right away and throw out the name of an animal, an elephant, a bear, a butterfly, each whore and her animal. It's strange because with other people, when he asks them about the animals, they simply don't catch on, but the whores just go along with it. Which gets me thinking that the next time a television crew arrives, I bring one of them instead of my wife. And that way it will be more natural. They look great, cheap, but great. And my son gets along better with them too. When he asks my wife what animal she is, she always insists, "I'm not an animal, sweetie, I'm a person, I'm your mommy." And then he always starts to cry. Why can't she just go with the flow, my wife? Why is it so easy for her to call women with cheap perfume whores? But when it comes to telling a little boy, "I'm a giraffe," it's more than she can handle. It really gets on my nerves. Makes me want to hit someone. Not her. Her I love, but someone. To take out my frustrations on someone who has it coming. Right-wingers can take it out on Arabs. Racists on blacks. But those of us who belong to the liberal left are trapped. We've boxed ourselves in. We have nobody to take it out on. "Don't call them whores," I railed to my wife. "You don't know for a fact that they're whores, do you? You've never seen anyone pay them or anything. So don't call them that, okay? How would you feel if someone called you a whore?" "Great," the German reporter says. "I love it. The crease in your forehead, the frenzied keystrokes. Now all we need are an intercut with translations of your books in different languages so our viewers can tell how successful you are. And that hug from your son one more time. The first time he ran up to you so quickly that Georg, our cameraman, didn't have a chance to change the focus. My wife wants to know if the German reporter needs her to hug me again too. And in my heart, I pray she'll say yes. I'd really love my wife to hug me again. Her smooth arms tightening around me as if there's nothing else in the world but us. "No need," the German says in an icy voice. "We've got that already." "What animal are you?" my son asks the German, and I quickly translate into English. "I'm not an animal," she laughs, running a long fingernail through his hair. "I'm a monster. A monster that came from across the ocean to eat pretty little children like you." She says she's a songbird. I translate to my son with impeccable naturalness. She says she's a red-feathered songbird who flew here from a faraway land. Thanks. So The second story I want to read is a short one. I think the story I have to tell about this story is much probably longer than the story itself. But the thing is that I have a lot of things in my pocket. I always carry a lot of stuff in my pocket. In lectures, I can hide behind podiums, but when I go out, you see that I'm a guy who has lots of stuff in his pocket. And usually when I travel, I have much, much less. And the thing is that usually when I put something inside my pocket, if I don't have a good reason, I will not take it out, you know? And this, sometimes when this good reason presents itself, you know, and I can find a firecracker or a candy or a toothpick in it, you know, people around me are very grateful, so I had no incentive to change my habits. Now, in Israel, it depends on which period, but many times when you go to shopping malls, they have metal detectors. And in one of my visit to a shopping mall, I went through the metal detector and beeped. And of course, the security guy, who seemed very bored and unhappy, he asked me to take all the things out of my pockets. And while I do that, all the other people have to wait. And I started taking things out of my pocket, and this seemed to be a never-ending process. And as I took all those things out of my pocket, I saw the guy kind of changes his mood, you know, from boredom into amazement, into contempt, into disgust, you know. And when he saw that I don't have any bombs on me, and I started putting the things back, I really wanted to say something to him, you know. Really wanted to say something in my defense, you know, because I saw how he looked at me, and I really want to say to him, you know, I'm a good guy, you know. But usually in life, I don't know what to say, you know. So I got back home and I wrote this story. And the story is called, "What Do We Have in Our Pockets?" A cigarette lighter, a cough drop, a postage stamp, a slightly bent cigarette, a toothpick, a handkerchief, a pen, 2 5-shekel coins. That's only a fraction of what I have in my pockets. So is it any wonder they bulge? Lots of people mention it. They say, "What the fuck do you have in your pockets?" Most of the time, I don't answer. I just smile. Sometimes I even give a short, polite laugh, as if someone told me a joke. If they were to persist and ask me again, I'd probably show them everything I have. I might even explain why I need all that stuff on me, always. But they don't. What the fuck? A smile, a short laugh, an awkward silence, and we're on to the next subject. The fact is that everything I have in my pockets is carefully chosen, so I'll always be prepared. Everything is there, so I can be at an advantage at the moment of truth. Actually, that's not accurate. Everything is there, so I won't be at a disadvantage at the moment of truth. Because what kind of advantage can a wooden toothpick or a postage stamp really give you? But if, for example, a beautiful girl, you know what, not even beautiful, just charming, an ordinary-looking girl with an entrancing smile that takes your breath away, asks you for a stamp, or doesn't even ask, just stands there in the street next to a red mailbox on a rainy night with a stampless envelope in her hand and wonders if you happen to know where there's an open post office at that hour, and then gives a little cuff because she's cold, but also desperate, since deep in her heart she knows that there's no open post office in the area, definitely not in that at that hour. And at that moment of truth, she won't say, "What the fuck do you have in your pockets?" But she'll be so grateful for the stamp. Maybe not even grateful. She'll just smile that entrancing smile of her. An entrancing smile for a postage stamp. I'd go for a deal like that anytime, even if the price of stamps soars and the price of smiles plummets. After the smile, she'll say thank you and cough again. Because of the cold, but also because she's a little embarrassed. And I'll offer her a cough drop. "What else do you have in your pocket?" she'll ask. But gently, without the fuck and without the negativity. And I'll answer without hesitation. Everything you'll ever need, my love. Everything you'll ever need. So now you know, that's what I have in my pocket. A chance not to screw up. A slight chance, not big, not even probable. I know that, I'm not stupid. A tiny chance, let's say, that when happiness comes along, I can say yes to it, and not, sorry, I don't have a cigarette, toothpick, coin for the soda machine. That's what I have there, full and bulging. A tiny chance of saying yes and not being sorry. Thanks. So the truth is that I read it in one place, and this very, very nice elderly guy came to me, and he said, your books, they are pockets full of things, you know? And I said, put him, I said, wow, I never thought about that, but that's maybe true too. So the last thing I'm going to read, from the upcoming book, The Seven Good Years. I began writing during my compulsory army service, which was more than 25 years ago. And all my life I wrote fiction. Somehow, the difference between fiction and nonfiction for me was the difference between going out on an adventure and retelling an adventure. Because when you write fiction, especially the way that I do, when I begin writing a story, I don't know what's going to happen. I feel that, you know, I'm living, I'm creating a life for myself. And when you write nonfiction, then basically there's something that happened, maybe it moved you, and now you're sharing it with another person. It's not as exciting as creating a new word. But I feel maybe that the first kind of nonfiction piece that I wrote with some kind of conviction was a piece I wrote the day my son was born, which is the first piece in this book. And my son was born. When I took my wife in labor, we got to a hospital. We went to the maternity ward, and there were no doctors there. And I was hysterical, you know, my wife was in labor. I said, where are the doctors? Where are the doctors? You know, I was very angry. And as I started running in the empty corridor looking for them, I realized very quickly that there was a terrorist bombing, and they took all the doctors to take care of the wounded, so nobody was left there. So by the time I was able to bring a doctor by hand to my wife, her labor stopped, as if my son said, you know what, maybe it's not such a good idea to come out. Maybe I'll stay, let me think about it, you know? And there was something so powerful in this experience, because I think that, you know, the thing I like the most about writing is metaphors, the way that but you invent something that may be not real, but it's a kind of, it's a gateway to the truth. By making this metaphor, you connect to something that is real. And I couldn't help thinking that, you know, that life had delivered me this metaphor. You know, what had happened had resonated a lot of things that had to do with my fear of having a child. I remember telling my mother, I said to her, you know, I'm an optimistic guy, and I always try to be optimistic, but, you know, I see life around me, and I don't know if I can, after all we've been through the past years, I don't know if I can bring a child to this world. And my mother said, if I went through the Holocaust and brought you, I think you can handle this too. You know, if I could believe things can get better, you can also believe that things can get better. And my son was born, and I found myself from time to time writing about him. Sometimes I would publish it in the live section in the New York Times, sometimes in Tablet. It's a portal, a Jewish portal on the web. And at some stage, my father got really ill. He had smoker's cancer. He smoked 2 packs a day since the age of 15. And I remember when he got the cancer, you know, he was over 80. And he said, you know, for all the joy I had from cigarettes, getting a cancer now is a pretty good deal. He said, it's like, I don't regret it, you know. If they would tell me, I would do this again. And he was the only person, you know, when I spent all his last months, we spent them together, that the things that he hated the most about the radiation tests, that during the radiation tests, he wasn't allowed to smoke the radiation treatments. So he would just, like, you know, even in the chemo, sometimes he would drag it in the corridor and light a cigarette, you know. He says, you know, the good negates the bad, you know, it's a, this cigarette doesn't count. After my father, during his illness, I wrote a lot about my father. And I also started developing these kind of strange habits that when I would have events, I would start telling stories about my father. And at the International Jerusalem International Festival, not long after my father had died, I told a story about him on stage. And after this event, in the audience was a writer that I call him my friend, even though we didn't get to meet so many times in life, but we feel very close. His name is Alexander Heimon. And he came to me, and he held my hand. He's a really, really big guy, you know. He's like he looks like a Cossack, you know. He's like big and bold. And he said to me, look at me, look at me. I said, yes, you know. And he said, you got to write a book about your family. And I said to him, you know, I don't like writing nonfiction. You know, actually, you know, the only true story that I had, which I felt that had to be written, I convinced another friend of mine, Nathan Englander, to write it. I said to him, I can't write something that had really happened. You write it beautifully. And he wrote a story called Free Fruit for Young Widows, based on stories that had to do with my father. But going on, I looked at all the pieces that I've already written, and I thought about more pieces that I can write, and I wrote this book. It's called The 7 Good Years, and basically it's the 7 years between the birth of my son and the death of my father, which were the 7 years in which I was lucky enough, you know, to be a father to my son and a son to my father, to have a tiny family, but still kind of this feeling of continuation. And in this book, I write about all my family. You know, I have 2 siblings. The eldest, my brother, he's a left-wing activist, and he started the legalized marijuana movement in Israel. And he's a genius. He finished high school when he was 14, and did a degree in math and computers, and after about 10 years ago, him and his wife, they moved to Thailand, where they continue their social activities from a tree house with a high-speed internet. And my sister, who's in the middle, she became ultra-Orthodox, and she has so far 12 children and 13 grandchildren. The 13th one was born in Brooklyn less than a week ago. And she's 51, so I hope there will be more. I feel like, you know, in the book I tried to reflect on the fact that, you know, we have such different political opinion in my family. You know, my sister used to live in a settlement for a long time. My brother was a left-wing anti-Zionist. My father was in the Irgun, which meant that he was a very active Likud supporter until Netanyahu joined the Likud. And so we had many different opinions in our family, but still there was something about it that I felt at the time was a strong metaphor for at least what I yearned Israel will be, which is a loving family in which people disagree, you know. So I want to read the last piece in the book, which basically takes place not in the last Gaza war, but in the war before that. My son, who's 9 years old, had already been through 2 wars, you know. In both of them, there were missile attacks, but sometimes, like, you know, from distance, all wars look the same. When you leave them, you can tell the differences. So this one is not the recent one. And the piece is called the Pastrami. The air raid siren catches us on the highway driving to Shira's father's place north of Tel Aviv. Shira pulls over to the side of the road, and we get out of the car, leaving the badminton rackets and feathered ball on the back seat. Lev holds my hand and says, "Daddy, I'm a little nervous." He's 7, and 7 is the age when it's not considered cool to talk about fear, so the word nervous is used instead. Following home front command instructions, Shira lies down on the side of the road. I tell Lev that he has to lie down too, but he keeps standing there, his small sweaty hand clutching mine. "Lie down already," Shira says, raising her voice to be heard over the blaring siren. He doesn't, and I remain standing too. "How would you like to play a game of pastrami sandwich?" I ask Lev. "What's that?" he asks, not letting go of my hand. "Mommy and I are slices of bread," I explain, "and you're a slice of pastrami, and we have to make a pastrami sandwich as fast as we can. Let's go. First you lie down on Mommy," I say, and Lev lies down on Shira's back and hugs her as hard as he can. I lie on top of them, pressing against the damp earth with my hands so as not to crush them. "This feels good," Lev says and smiles. "Being the pastrami is the best," Shira says under him. "Pastrami," I yell. "Pastrami," my wife yells. "Pastrami," Lev yells, his voice shaky, either from excitement or fear. "Daddy," Lev says, "look, there are ants crawling on Mommy." "Pastrami with ants," I yell. "Pastrami with ants," my wife yells. "Yuck," Lev yells. And then we hear the boom, loud but far away. We stay lying one on top of the other without moving for a long time. My arms are starting to hurt from carrying my weight. From the corner of my eye, I can see other drivers who've been lying on the highway get up and brush the dirt off their clothes. I start to stand up. "Lie down," Lev tells me. "Lie down, Daddy, you're ruining the sandwich." I lie down for another minute and say, "Okay, game's over, we won." "But it's nice," Lev says. "Let's stay like this a little more." We stay like that a few seconds longer. Mommy on the bottom, Daddy on top, and Lev and a few red ants in the middle. When we finally get up, Lev asks where the rocket is. I point in the direction from which the explosion came. "It sounded like it exploded not far from our house," I say. "Oof," Lev says, disappointed. "Now Lav will probably find pieces again. Yesterday he came to school with a piece of iron from the last rocket, and it had the symbol of the company on it and the name in Arabic. Why did it have to explode so far away?" "Better far away than close by," Shira says as she wipes sand and ants off her pants. "The best would be if it was far enough away so nothing happens to us, but close enough so I could pick up some pieces," Lev sums up. "The best would be badminton on Grandpa's Jonathan's lawn. I disagree with him and open the door to the back seat of the car. "Daddy," Lev says as I'm buckling him in, "promise that if there's another siren, you and Mommy will play pastrami with me again." "I promise," I say. "And if it gets boring, I'll teach you how to play grilled cheese." "Great," Lev says. And a second later, he adds more seriously, "But what if there aren't any more sirens, ever?" "I think there will be at least one or two more. Don't worry," I reassure him. "And if not," Shira adds from the front seat, "we can play it without the sirens, too."
So we certainly have time for questions. We have a couple of microphones at the front. Anyone who would like to ask a question, can you go turn that one on? Please just make your way to one of the microphones. I guess I'll start you off, Etgar.
Okay.
And if you can talk about how, you know, I know you go all around the world, and has your experience changed over the years and as an Israeli author going to different parts of the world?
Well, I must say that I traveled so long that I've been like through many ups and downs, you know, because I began writing and publishing during the Oslo Accord, you know, when Israel was really, really popular and loved, and then, you know, at the time of the Second Intifada and at the time of the disengagement, you know, so Of course, you know, there are always people who are who support us and people who are not. I wanted to say pro-Israeli, you know, but I hate this term so much. Because not pro-Israeli, but I find it very reductive because, you know, I was once interviewed, I was in a bad mood, I admit, by a woman who was very obnoxious to begin with, and she said to me, an Italian journalist, and she said, just before the interview, I want to be honest with you, I'm pro-Palestinian. And I said to her, you know, just to be honest with you, I'm pro-girls with big boobs. And she said, how dare you say something like that? And I said to her, why? I like girls with big boobs. You know, what's the problem? And she said, you can't generalize all the girls. I said, well, you know, if you can generalize all the Palestinians and all the Israelis, I said, it's the same kind of act, you know. The moment that you say I'm a priorically pro someone, then you make him simpler than a human being, you know. I love the people of Israel. I love many... everything in my life is in Israel, my language is there. If you can say if I'm a priorically pro-Israeli, which means do I think everything that Israel does is right? No, I don't think that, you know. I feel that as somebody who had traveled around for many times, I feel that, let's say, especially in Europe, but I think also in the US in the past year or so, especially after the war, it became much harder. It's like, if I count the intervals between the time, you know, that I'm called a baby killer and that people shout to me that I have blood on my hands, then it's more frequent now than it used to be.
A few months ago, Palabolas, the dance troupe, was here in Cleveland and did one of your stories. Could you tell us what it was like to work with the dance troupe? How that went?
Yes, it was a wonderful experience, you know, because first of all, I don't really see myself as a writer. I see myself much more as a storyteller. And as a storyteller, you know, like if I could draw a story or tap dance a story, you know, I would give it a shot. When I started doing films, I made film because I wanted to become a better writer, and I believe that if I would experiment with different genres, I would learn things about storytelling that I could then take back to writing, because there is something about writing which is pretty strange for me, that you know that when you start writing, then basically what I write about is my interactions with human beings, but the more successful you become, the less interactions you have with human beings, or the less kind of interactions in which you're in a symmetric relationship with human beings. Because, you know, when I come and speak on stage, and of course I can talk to people, but it's not the same as if I work with somebody in an office. So I always enjoyed collaboration, especially with other artists, trying to understand what they're doing, where it's coming from. Me and my wife were offered to work with Pilobulus, I said to them, listen, I don't think I'm your guy. And they said, why? And I said, well, to be honest, I never saw a dance show in my life. And they said, well, that sounds good. We always wanted to work with somebody who never saw a dance show in his life. You won't be affected by anything, you know. And when we came there, you know, in the beginning, we improvised together, and my wife and I and the people of Pilobus, you know, we gave ideas and the ideas turned into dances, and then we had to stop our process because one of the people we worked in got very ill. He had cancer and he had to be treated. So we waited for a year, and a year later, when we came to continue the process, you know, they sent us the videos and they say, "Oh, we saw them, and it's so great to continue this process." And I said to them, "You know, a year had passed. I looked at them. I don't like them." And they say, why? And I said to them, you know, I think that that in a sense, in this interaction, I became some kind of a second, a B-level choreographer. My wife is better than me, so you know, maybe she was an A-minus choreographer. But I said, you know, the things that I know is to tell stories. And they said, yeah, but you know, it's a dance. It's not Broadway, you know. We dance. We don't talk. We don't have dialogue. You know, it's all through movement. We the dancers create things. And I say, yeah, but you can still create a story like that. And they're amazing people. And they say, you know what, it's worth a shot. You know, let's do it. And basically, my wife and I and the three of the people of Pilobolos, we were just together. And we started by inventing a situation, a basic situation, which was about family. You know, the issue of family is, did you see the dance? So I would say the grandfather has a lot to do with my father. But the show was called The Inconsistent Peddler. And the idea about it was that in every family, there is always this person who peddles the family on the stage. It's the one that goes on the bicycle. It keeps all the light on. It keeps the music. It keeps the movement. The moment he stops peddling, everybody will kind of stop, you know, functioning as a family. It's always the guy who makes the call and says, let's go to Seder, or let's go visit the brother, or let's go visit the aunt, or makes peace between people who in the family who have a fight. And what I discovered is that I'm a peddler in my family. You know, my father used to be, and I inherited this peddling duty, but I discovered that people peddle in a different way. Some people peddle kind of in a very neurotic and nervous way, and they're very unhappy. They're exhausted, you know. And some people peddle because it's fun to ride a bicycle, you know. And you can peddle in different ways. And in the dance, the different peddling creates different dynamic in the families. They can be harmonic, they can be disharmonic, you know. And the story of a girl who learns that she can peddle in different ways and that her relationship with her family can change was something that came from this process. And I must say, I really, really learned a lot about stories. Because for me, like, you know, the first thing I rely on is language and words and dialogue. Even when I do movies, you know, I think a lot about the visual, but this is always important for me too. And to work without words was a first experience and a very educating one.
Your style of storytelling, both in written and in talking, is very intimate and somewhat exposed. Do you feel vulnerable when you write? Can you talk a little bit about your writing process and how it feels then once you have put this out there into the world? What that feels like to you as the author?
Yeah, so I want to say that for me there is a huge difference between writing fiction and writing nonfiction. When I published my first collection of short stories, I had a story there that I wrote about a girl that I really, really loved, but I never told her that I loved her because she had a boyfriend. And we were like those platonic friends, you know, pretending that, you know, that everything's okay. And this story began as a birthday card. You know, when you write to somebody, I wish you, you know, that you have a wonderful year and stuff. But as I wrote it, there was some kind of bitterness getting into it because it had to do with the fact that, you know, we were in one relationship, I wanted to be in another. And very quickly I said, this is not a birthday card. So I put it aside, you know, wrote something standard, bought a box of chocolate and get on going. And this card stayed on my table and I found myself writing a story from it. But when I wrote the story, I said to myself, you know, I can't publish this story. Even though at the time me and the girl were not in any contact, but I said, you know, she's going to read it, she's going to call me, it's going to be awkward. I won't publish this book. But as I wrote in, I keep digressing all the time, that's very Jewish of me. But I have a story that the protagonist is a hired killer. And the guy says that whenever he gets an envelope, before he opens it, he knows he's going to kill the guy. And he says, it doesn't matter if it's a child, if it's a smiling elderly woman, I know I'm going to kill them. He says, because in my business, you either kill them all or you don't kill them at all. If you say this guy doesn't deserve to die, nobody deserves to die. You want to do this work, you do this work. So in a sense, I felt the same about publishing a story. I said, I wrote a good story. You know, if it will get me into trouble, if it will put me in an awkward moment, I'll have to handle it. And to prove myself I'm brave, I even put it as the first story in my first collection. And I published it, and at the time, me and that girl, we didn't speak to each other in a year. The day the book hit the stand, she calls me. I pretend to be surprised. She says to me, you know, I bought the book, and I read the story you wrote about me, and I cried. And I said to her, what story? And she said, don't lie to me. You know that we both know that you wrote a story about me. And I said to her, I didn't write any story about you. And she said, I can prove it to you. And then she started talking about details, but in a different story. And I quickly admitted that it was about her. That story was actually a story I wrote about my sister. And after that, after apologizing for not saying it on the start, and wishing her and her boyfriend, who was now her husband, wonderful lives. They got divorced after a few years. But after that, I realized this great truth about fiction, that when I write, I don't retell things that had happened. What I write about an emotion. And this emotion is very, very abstract, but I put it in something that is structured. And what happens is that when people read it, I can read it on stage and cry. And you can say, wow, it's very intimate. But you don't know why I'm crying, because you don't know the context in my life. So I feel it's like a cipher. I can always, I can be as open as I want to be, but at the same time, I'm very much protected. But with nonfiction, it's not the same. And I must say that I feel that this was always, for me, a turn off dealing with nonfiction, because when you write nonfiction about something that had happened, it had happened, The person, your father is your father, your son is your son. It's not like those stories that I can say to you, the son is not my son, it's me when I was a child, So it doesn't work this way. People sometimes read it this way, I have a story breaking the pig, and in the story there is a bullying father. So many people say, your father was that bad? And I say, it's not about my father. It's me at school. When I was in elementary school, that's how I felt, when I wrote this book, I think that one of the things, I felt very, very ambiguous about publishing it. And the compromise I've reached with myself was that I'll publish it, but not in Israel. I wrote it in Hebrew, but it was edited in English. It comes out in many countries. It will come out in the US in June, but it came already in France, in Spain, in Mexico. It's coming in Italy now. And the things that was important for me, it felt like, there are those stories that are easier to tell to somebody who sits next to you in a plane than to your next door neighbors. And I felt that these were these kind of stories. And I know that many people in Israel will read them, but I don't want them to be in this focus point. And I must say that, that with this book coming out in English in a couple of months, I'm very nervous about it. I was never that nervous when my fiction books came out. Because, when somebody tells you the story that you wrote is boring and shallow, I say, okay, you didn't like it. But when somebody says your relationship with your dying father is boring and shallow, then you feel much more vulnerable. And in Israel, they can say that. We dugri, We say it straight. So many people came to me, They say, they buy a book, they say, write it to my sister. I don't read your stuff anymore. The first book was good, but all the others,
I wonder when you write either nonfiction or fiction, if you visualize the events and interactions or if your focus is more on words.
That's a very good question. It's really because I think that many times there is something for me very magical about the writing process. So when many times when I write a story and say, how did I do that? I want to do it again. What happened? And I thought about it a lot, and I realized that that there is always a trigger for a story, and I realized that the triggers that are visual. Let's say I have a story, the bus driver wanted to be God, and it came from a woman that I saw begging to a bus driver that he will open the gates of the bus, looking up at him, and it looked like, she's praying to God. So I wrote it in a third-person narrative because I saw it, so I was a, I was a bystander looking at it, and stories that come from a sentence or a word that I hear, I usually write in first person, because I take this sentence in and it becomes a monologue, and then I become the speaker. But I think that you know that some of them come from visual things and some of them come from speech and language. Although my wife says, not in writing, but in general, that I'm too much in the language and not enough in the world around me. Wow. You're fur people.
You have a very unusual first name, which in English means challenge.
Yes.
How did your parents come up with that first name?
Oh, yeah. So you see, this is a question that usually I'm not asked, but here it's the second time that they ask me, and that's why I say I feel at home, because it's a very... I think it's something very warm about this question. So I am called Challenge. It's a very, very difficult... it was a difficult name. I wouldn't say to live with. As a kid, I really liked it. But in the compulsory army service, when you're called Challenge, and your sergeant major says, Challenge, you have a challenge, go clean the toilets. And he sees that all the regiment is laughing. And then he says, Challenge, you have another challenge, go clean the other regiment's toilets, because he wants them to laugh again. It's very difficult. And I must say that, you know, we had double bunks bed. And the guy on the bunk above me was called, his family name was Aftel. And Aftel is the slang in Israeli army for one day leave. So there were so many times when they said, after, go get an after, which means go home. And then I said, what about me? I say, challenge, you have a challenge. Go clean another toilet that we forgot about. So it's not always easy. And the story behind it is that my mother always wanted to have many children. She wasn't very healthy when she came as a child of war, you know. But she was lucky enough to have my brother and sister. And then after that, she had a series of miscarriages. And when she was already not in a young age, she got pregnant with me, and there were complications in the pregnancy. And I got this disease when you become yellow, jaundice or something. And the umbilical cord was tied around my neck. And the doctor said to her, he's going to die anyway. So we better take him out in pieces, you know, so you still be alive. And, you know, you still have two children home. We must have an abortion. And my mother said no. And the doctor said to her, you will die. So she said, my husband is a good man. He'll take care of my two children. And she insisted on having a cesarean operation. I was born in 6 months of pregnancy. I weighed less than a kilo. I was totally yellow. Everybody was sure I was going to die. She called me a challenge because she said it was a challenge to have me, and it was also a challenge that I stay alive. So that's where my name comes from.
Shalom uvrakotlika. I was one of Neely Adler's students. Last time you were here, she had us read the script to your film, Jellyfish. I thought that was absolutely magnificent.
My wife wrote it, by the way. But thanks.
It was awesome. But anyhow, I was curious as to what the inspiration was for writing that. And also, at the ending, if I recall correctly, there's a young girl who goes under the water and never comes out again. And I wondered what the symbolism of that was. If you could address those.
So one thing I can say in general, when it comes to explaining stories or movies, it's like in a magic show, you know. We don't tell our tricks. You have to figure them on your own. But I do think it's a wonderful screenplay. I can tell you the story behind making this movie is that my wife wrote this wonderful screenplay, and her background, she came from theater, and she's a poet. So when she wrote the screenplay, I told her, you know, I know many film people because I also write screenplays. So I said to her, pick your three favorite directors, and I'll go to each of them, and we do like a bid. You know, each of them will say how he sees the movies, and the ones that will seem nicest to you, let him direct it. And we gave them to those three directors, and none of them wanted to direct it. And, you know, and one of them was a very close friend of mine and a wonderful director. He said, because she's your wife, you think it's a screenplay, but it's an 80-page poem. It's not a screenplay. It's not how you write a screenplay. And I was very angry, and I said to my wife, we don't need them. We can direct it on our own. And my wife said, but we've never been on a set, and we never studied how to direct. And I said to her, you know, that's the problem with you. You know why? Because when a husband tells you we can do something, you don't discourage him. You say, yes, my beloved husband, I'm going to do it with you. And my wife was intimidated because I said it in a very kind of... She said, okay, we can do it. I'm with you. And then she went to sleep, and I couldn't fall asleep because I said, you know, I won the argument, but what am I going to do now? And for me, it was a very, very interesting process. Also, what excited me about it was directing a screenplay I didn't write, but was so close to my life. And I won't tell you about the little girl because I want it to be open for any interpretation. But what I can tell you, that if you remember the last shot in the movie, they meet the ice cream man. So the ice cream man is my father, my late father. Yeah, so, and by the way, it was very difficult to direct because when you're an ice cream man, you have a big box of popsicles. And before we started shooting, somebody from the production came and said, your father ate all the popsicles, you know, so. But he was just right for the part.
Can I ask Inibu?
What?
Can I ask Inibu?
Yes, and I will translate it in my beautiful, accentless English.
Okay. אז הרבה מהסיפורים שלך הם בנקודת מבט של ילד קטן או נער. למה?
Okay, so the question is that many of my stories are from the point of view of a child. Why do I write many stories from the point of view of a child? So I can tell you something very interesting. Because until this day, you know, my son is 9 years old. I find it much easier communicating with children than communicating with adults. Not only with my son, with his friends too. There is something I think I'm more attentive to subtext than to text. And with children, the subtext and text are closer to each other. When they're unhappy, they cry. When they're up, you know, with grown-ups, many times the gaps between the two, they cause a lot of complications. For me, it causes a lot of miscommunication. By the way, I must say, in the U.S., it happens to me much more in Israel, because in Israel, we're more kind of, you know, straight. But many times, you know, when somebody, let's say, in my publishing house in the U.S., says something and means something else, I say, but he said that, so he probably, you know, it's like I was a Sundance advisor in the Sundance Institute, the Robert Redford Sundance Institute, and you meet all those movie stars, and before you leave, they give you their phone numbers, and they say, if you're ever in L.A., call me, I have a big house, come and sleep in my... And there was another Israeli there, and he saw that I collect all the numbers, and he says to me, why do you collect them? I said, I go to L.A., you know, why pay for a hotel? You know, this guy, you know, he must have a big house. And he said, they say it, they don't mean it, you know. So he made me throw those numbers away. So with children, it was always easy for me to understand them, and I think that there was something in the child point of view that I feel it's like, let's say, if life is, you drive inside a car, then when you're a child, people ask you to get into the car. So you're just in this position where you can see all those blind spots that the people in the car can't see. You know, you don't have to be a devil's advocate. You don't have to be sophist. You don't have to, you just look at things and see that people are doing something or saying something, and you can be very direct and sincere about it, and many times expose things that would be exposed for a grown-up because he would be blind to seeing them. You know, I'm just giving a silly example, but you know, homeless people are called homeless people. When we meet them in the street, sometimes we help them, right? We give them money, we don't give them a home, you know? But my son could say to me, if he's homeless, why, we have an extra bed, why don't we take him, you know? So it's a valid question. As a grown-up, I wouldn't ask myself that question, you know? So that's what attracted me to the child point of view. I must say that I wrote many stories about parent and children relationship. from the moment my son was born, I kept writing on those relationships, but suddenly I started writing on them from the parent side. It was really suddenly there was some kind of reverse of roles, and it was very interesting for me. You know, sometimes I can compare stories and I say, wow, I wrote this story very close to it in spirit from the child's point of view, and now I'm writing it from the father's point of view. I'm waiting for my grandparents' point of view stories, you know, which will hopefully come one day.
Thank you.
Well, in your last book of short stories, there's like one of the stories called Lyland. And I was fascinated with it, and I was curious what's the background and where it came from.
Lyland, yeah. Well, Lyland, first I want to say that it's a story about a person who finds a way to get to a world. And in this world, every time we make a lie, this lie is created. In the sense that, let's say, if I come and I say, you know, I was late for work because my car hit a dog and I had to take him to the vet, so there is a limping dog in that world. And the story is basically about this guy, when he enters there, he meets his first lie, he meets other people's lie. He befriends a lie of this young Russian woman immigrant. And this lie, he's this uncle that whenever she doesn't want to do something, she said, my uncle had a stroke. My uncle was attacked by a pack of wolves. My uncle was hit by a bus, you know, and this guy, he already lost his hands. He can't see in one eye. He's limping, you know. And when, by mistake, he meets this girl, he wants to convince her to stop making those lies and making different lies instead. I think that I made this story because I think that for me there is something about writing stories that is basically lying. You know, it's really, you write things that are not true about characters that had never existed. And the things that I kind of tell myself is that there are different kinds of lies, you know? In the stories, there is this kind of part where he talks about, it's like when he discovers that every time he lies, it's created in the world, he starts telling positive lies. Like, you know, I couldn't come because there was this woman I met, she won the lottery, I had to give her a ride to her son. But what he discovers is that when you tell positive lies, people tend not to believe you. When you say, this kind of responsibility for your lies and the fact that you create things in the world, it seemed to me close to fiction. And it also helped me talk about things that I really believe, you know, I lie sometimes, you know, more than most people. I don't feel guilty about that. I feel guilty about many things. You know, if you have the time, next weekend there will be a piece from the book in the New York Times Weekends magazine. They have the live section, so they'll have a piece there. And in the piece, you see, when you read the piece, it's a piece about me lying. And the part that I'm lying, I have no problem about. I lie to my kids, I'm totally fine with it. The part in which I'm actually not lying is the part that I was very embarrassed about. So I feel that, let's say, lying is like a hammer, you know. If you use it to put a nail in the wall and to put a nice picture, it's okay. If you hit somebody on the head with it, it's not right. But the fact that we a priori put all lies in one box, you know, it's like being a pro-Palestinian, you know. So I'm saying, you know, don't be anti-lies. Just look at the intention of the person who's telling them. Did he tell it out of compassion? Did he tell it out of malice? Was it egocentric? Was he trying to help? You know, I think it's about that.
I can ask in Hebrew too?
Yeah. You see, I'm a very good interpreter.
הרבה מהסיפורים הקצרים שלך מופיעים מבחינות הבגרות ונלמדים בבתי הספר. האם אתה חושב שזה עולם שילדים נחשפים לשפה בוטה שיש לך בסיפורים, ועוד במקצוע שמשדר רצינות?
מה המשפט האחרון? ששפה בוטה, ומה היה אחרי זה?
ועוד במקצוע שמשדר רצינות.
משדר רצינות?
כן.
אוקיי. I try to interpret it properly. The question is that many of my stories are in the high school curriculum, and students have to learn them for their final exams. And the question, do I think it's appropriate that children will read the stories that have explicit language in a profession that is supposed to be serious, right? Yeah. Well, first of all, you know, explicit language is very, very serious. You know, many people talk to me in explicit language, and they were very serious. I had to run very fast, you know, after they talked to me like that. But what I want to say, you know, I think that some people have a mistake when they think that literature's role is to beautify life. It's kind of like, you know, it's like we live in our life, you know, the husband beats the wife, you know, the children steal from each other. But when we go outside, we're all right, we're nice. How are you doing, Mr. Mitzenmacher? Did you have a good day? You know, literature is not about that. Literature is all about reflexiveness. Everything that exists in our world can and maybe should be represented in literature. If you look at the Israeli high school curriculum, then one of the books being learned is a Crime and Punishment by Dostoevsky. It's basically a story about a student who kills a woman who didn't do anything to him and falls in love with a prostitute, you know? And it's not a story my father made, you know, Dostoevsky wrote it. So you say, why teach children stories about, you know, about, can't they teach a story about somebody who grew up and became a doctor, you know? Why should they tell a story about a killer? I think that there is something, maybe I digress a little bit and I tell you what I think that literature is all about. I think that literature is basically some kind of an exercise. Like when we go to the gym, we exercise our muscle. When we read, we exercise our muscle of empathy. What we do is that when we read, we enter a different world, we enter the different mind, we enter a different context, and we learn, in a sense, what it means to be a different person in our world. So I think that we allow ourselves to do that just because it's not real, you know, because I can say to you, let's say if I wrote a book about an Afghani immigrant taxi driver who comes to Cleveland and his family is in Afghanistan and he sends them money, you know, and he writes poems for his child, you know, I would love to read this book, you know, I would love to see the immigrant neighborhood in which he lives. I would love to cry with him when he writes those letters to his son. But if I, tomorrow, when I go to the airport, the driver will start talking to me, you know, I say to him, excuse me, I'm writing an email. Okay, sorry. Can you take the short ride and turn on the meter, please? Because in real life, we're intimidated. The other is a possible risk, you know. If this taxi driver will say, come to my neighborhood, they say, oh, but they're going to rob me. But in fiction, it's safe enough for us to lay off our guard and to know what it means to be the other. And in this sense, I don't think that literature is there to know what it means to be nice people. Nice people, we're not scared of them even in real life. And I don't even believe in this concept of nice and not nice people. I think, you know, it's not that I'm a relativist, but I think that all of us have an unnice side to us. I think that the morality of stories, that we learn from stories, it doesn't come from Star Wars. You know, when you see a movie and you see in the movie Luke Skywalker fighting with Darth Vader, and he's good and Darth Vader is bad and he kills Darth Vader and the good guys wins, this doesn't give you any moral lesson. Because you know why? Because when ISIS people see this movie, they also identify with Luke Skywalker. Everybody in the story of his life, everybody is a good guy, you know? I think, but when you read Crime and Punishment, you say, wow, here's a guy who could be me, and he kills somebody. Maybe I should be careful, you know? This is the place where I think literature gets its real importance. So, of course, when I write about a difficult situation. I write about people who use harsh language, you know? I use curse words. I don't try to go only to the safe zones. I actually try mostly to go to those zones that would make me feel some unrest. You know, if I read a story, and when I read all the stories, there isn't even one sentence about which I'm uncomfortable. It's not a good reading for me. I know myself well enough. There's always a sentence in which I stutter a little bit, or in which I look at the audience and hope that the audience doesn't feel that I look at them. Or I say, oh, maybe I shouldn't have read that. You know, it's like I can tell you when I read What Animal Are You, there is this bit there where he says, where he says racists can take their anger out on Arabs. Right-wingers on Arabs, I don't remember how to go, racists on blacks. So I read this story in Harlem to a black audience. When I was, you know, I was behind the podium, my knees were like this. But I read the story because the story is not about how it's cool to be racist. You know, the story is, the statement, it doesn't matter what words I use. When you dig under them, I talk about a sincere emotion that I don't think that anybody should have trouble with. The fact that I fix that doesn't necessarily mean that the readers will think that, but that's the thing that motivated me to write it. Yes.
Many people think that maybe writing can be taught. I wonder if you believe that anyone has helped to teach you, or if you have been taught to improve your writing in some way.
Well it's funny because you know, when I started the writing, I came from a town, you know, Ramat Gan, and in my neighborhood I didn't know any artist. You know, when I wrote stories, I didn't even know what I'm doing. I read books, but I didn't have any reference or any guidance whatsoever. But I think that the lessons that I've learned were actually lessons from life, which I adapted into writing. You know, when I see, let's say, my sister, she's religious, so through her, like to be close to her, I've read many Hasidic stories. She's a Breslover. I learned a lot from Hasidic stories. You know, my father's, the way he dealt with his word, with the word, I learned a lot about writing from him. My mother, every people I know, and of course from writers. I think that first and foremost, what you learn from writers is that usually when you sit down and you want to write, there is some kind of a confined space. You know, you say, let's say, the first thing you want to do when you sit down and you want to write, you write in high register. You want to write nice sentences. You want to write something that is important. You know, there's always this kind of feeling. And I think that when you read fiction, like all those boundaries, you see that it's as if there was a wall, and then you see Kafka takes a step to the right, and there is no wall anymore. So they kind of broaden and broaden the space, and they give you courage to do it yourself. But, you know, so in the beginning, I was very kind of, I wouldn't say anti, but I was very suspicious about teaching writing. Today, I'm a professor in the Ben-Gurion University, and I give writing workshop. And the first thing I say to my students, I say to them, this is not a lesson. This is a support group. This is like an AA meeting, you know? We will each get up and say, my name is Etgar, and I write stories. What can I do? I like it, you know? And in this confined space, we will have that things that we don't have in the outside world, which is basically, in the world, the last thing people need from us is to write stories. You know, I mean, like, if I don't take my child from school, you know, he'll cry. You know, if I won't earn a living, my wife will shout at me. You know, if I won't visit my mother, you know, she'll give me a long face. But if I don't write, nobody will do anything to me. So I think that creative writing workshop can create this atmosphere in which you have a group that wants to read your stories and wants to comment on them and doesn't see it as a chore. I think that it's a system that is good for some people and very bad for others. I think that it is very, very individual because it's a very intimate relationship. So I think that, let's say, many good writers are not necessarily good workshop instructors, or I would say that some people are good for one student and not good for the other. And I always say to my students in the first lesson, I say to them, listen, if you go home and you say, I'm not sure it's good for me, then it's not good for you, you know. But if you feel that it does give you some kind of a support and backwind, then keep coming. And I have a story, by the way, in the Sunday Knock on the Door called Creative Writing, which I think is just about that. It's about creative writing workshop. Thank you.